Perfetto.
It is a great honor to be here at this conference in honor of the midpoint of Ricardo's career. It's also, in a sense, an unexpected honor because I have Barbieri number two. Right? I mean, I worked with collaborators of Ricardo, but not with Ricardo. We bought a house together, and then we divided into, well, that's another story. It's late, and we are tired, and I'm tired at least. And also, when you are faced with this task of giving a talk at a conference in honor of a great colleague, you are faced with a dilemma, because sometimes you do not work on things that that interest the said person. And so you remember 1 year ago, here we have to go out of this. 1 year ago, we'll go just to full screen. I think that that's more human. When faced with a difficult decision, Al Gore asked, "What would Jesus do?" Well, that's a little bit ambitious, but we can ask. I can ask, "What would Ricardo do? Would he talk about things that are tailored to my taste, or will talk about things that he cares about?" And the answer is, of course, the latter. So I will do the same here, but I will try to be, well, technical, but not exceedingly technical, and give a review, an apology in both senses of the word, of why working in gravity, in particular, on this space, on Ante de Sitter 3, is interesting. Now, okay, so let's start with that. Why this space is interesting? ADS3, which is a three-dimensional space with negative curvature, as you know, has an infinite-dimensional asymptotic algebra. So the algebra of symmetries acting at very far away at the boundary of the space, which indeed has a boundary, is infinite-dimensional. It's not just finite as it happens in other dimensions. And at the classical level has a central charge. This was a surprise when it was discovered years ago. Large algebra means that more of the dynamics is determined just by symmetries and not by actually trying to solve the dynamics. There are no gravitational waves in pure ADS gravity, and that's a good thing. It's a good thing because it allows us to strip down gravity from a lot of complications and try to see if we can, at least in this baby version, answer some of the questions of quantum gravity. There is also this curious fact that the boundary of a three-dimensional space is two-dimensional. That's not curious, but that tells us that on the boundary we could have left-moving and right-moving excitations that stay separated and do not mix. And that allows, in a sense, the possibility of having a chiral half of gravity, a square root of gravity. So you could have, in a sense, a theory that is even simpler than pure gravity. And that's not what happens in higher dimensions. Also, Ante de Sitter possesses not only this before-mentioned asymptotic algebra, but it also possesses other asymptotic algebras that, in part, reduce dynamics to kinematics. And again, that's always a help, right? It's a very powerful handle to understand physics. And well, you know, this actually will, in a sense, this is not an exception, except that the square root may not exist quantum mechanically. Now, high spin fields also in three dimensions propagate 0 degrees of freedom in locally. They propagate boundary excitations, but exactly like the graviton, they propagate 0 three-dimensional degrees of freedom. But they are not free, nor they are described in terms of free fields. And again, this is in distinction with what happens in higher dimensions. So they are an ideal laboratory to trying to understand also high spin theories, not only gravity. So, let's start and say what is ADS. Well, ADS, up to conformal transformations, is a solid cylinder, and the surface of the cylinder, I mean this surface, the vertical one, is the boundary, is the conformal boundary of the space, which is time-like. The metric can be written in many, many coordinates. The metric that I wrote here is actually global. It covers the entire ADS space. Rho ranges from 0 to infinity, and phi is an angle at this time. And near the boundary, so the boundary in the coordinates I just wrote is for a large rho. So if I use a coordinate that vanishes at the boundary, z equals this thing, then of course the boundary would be z equal to 0. Near the boundary, the metric reduces to an expression that depends on the radial coordinate, call it z, call it rho, and it depends also on two chiral coordinates, w, two light cone coordinates. Yeah. And it's well known. Now, of course, if we want to study gravity in antidesiter 3, as many in this audience know, we have to introduce a metric, and that means that we shouldn't really take a metric that is exactly antidesiter. We can allow for small fluctuations, exactly as we can allow for small fluctuations of Minkowski space when we want to study gravity in an asymptotically flat background. So in equations, that means that the metric will be will have coefficients of order 1, right, that are fixed, plus small terms. And by the way, this GAB should have contained a factor of z square. I'm sorry for that. It was a misprint. Now, with G order of z square, the form of the metric that I gave here is preserved by not only the exact isometries of the space, but also by a more general set of coordinate transformations that, in terms of the boundary coordinates I gave before, has this phase. And as you see, these transformations depend on two arbitrary functions, an epsilon plus that depends only on the light cone coordinate W plus, and an epsilon minus, an independent variable that depends on W minus. So you have actually an infinite number of coordinate transformations, but less infinite than if you had generic coordinate transformations, because actually these functions are each one just a function of one coordinate. Right. Now, once you have an asymptotic metric and you have the symmetries, the general coordinate transformations, to be precise, that preserve that symmetry, you can also try to define conserved charges. And here I will give a very rough sketch of the general story. Now, if you look at the Einstein equation, as you know, there are certain of Einstein's equations that do not should not be thought as evolution equations, but as constraints that constrain the set of initial data of coordinates and momenta on a space-like surface. And in particular, those are the equations that contain, say, a time direction. So G zero mu. So you get four constraints. In case of ADS3, two constraints, right? Three, because you have 0, 1, 2, right? The coordinate is 0, 1, 2. And you get these three constraints. Okay, what do you do with them? You can vary them. You can actually, since these constraints hold point by point in space time, you can actually compute them on a hypersurface, an equal time hypersurface, or a space like hypersurface in general, multiply them by an arbitrary vector, and compute how these constraints change when you change the initial data. When they change, you get two terms, typically. You get a term that is it's actually the integral over the volume, in this case two-dimensional, of the variation of the metric, but then a term that depends on the gradient of the metric. Well, we don't like that term. It's not the classical variation. In a classical variation, you just vary the x coordinates, you don't take these derivatives, because some of this actually could be re-expressed in terms of other variations using the constraints. So the idea is that you want to add a boundary term that cancels this piece. So you want to, it won't change the constraint in the bulk, but it will eliminate this offending piece. And now you know how to add this constraint. Basically, you add the total derivative of these three pieces. And when you add that boundary term to the constraint, you call the sum of the two a change of the charge, and the change of the charge now would be just a variation of the constraint. Remember, here we are varying, but going from one allowed initial set of data to another allowed initial set of data. So this vanishes, and then you are left with this thing that is the change of a charge, actually a boundary charge. If it's integrable, so if you can actually integrate this for arbitrary finite variations within a class that you define a priori, then that defines a charge. This story was developed, I think, by Regenthal, Teitelbaum many years ago, and covers wide ranges of boundary conditions, even those that go well beyond asymptotic ADS. I mean, you can be creative, right, and give other conditions. So this covers it all. In particular, in the case that your space is asymptotically ADS, so it has the metric, the asymptotic metric that I gave a while ago, and for the coordinate transformations that preserve that asymptotic form, if you, instead of the coordinate of the functions epsilon, use their Fourier transforms, right, you'll get charges that are called Ln, and these are not only named, but in fact, actually, Virasoro charges. So when you can compute the Poisson brackets, because we are classical, so the commutators, right, of these two charges, and the Poisson brackets slash commutators will give you actually this piece. This you expect, because if the charge ended, I mean, if the algebra ended here, this would be the algebra of diffeomorphisms on the boundary, what we call epsilon plus and epsilon minus. But here there is a surprise. There is a central term. And in this expression, L is the anti de Sitter radius. Before I had put it to 1, now I restore it to L. And G is the Newton constant in 3 dimensions. And again, this is a classical result. So this doesn't require to quantize the theory and transform Poisson brackets into commutators. And it was due to Brown and Henault. This result actually was first found by Brown and Henault for this case, but it extends to many other asymptotic symmetries. You find the same fact that there are central terms in the algebra of asymptotic symmetries for three-dimensional theories, for Kac-Moody symmetries, for superconformal extensions of the Virasoro algebra, et cetera, et cetera. So the story has become very rich. And I will not cover this. I will just give just the flavor of what ADS can do. Remember, this is an apology. Now, the other interesting thing about three-dimensional anti-de Sitter is that pure gravity is actually a solvable system, at least in the sense that its dynamics is much, much simpler than in any other dimensions. You can see the fact that the key fact is that gravitational waves do not propagate in the bulk. The only dynamics that you have is the dynamics on the boundary plus a certain very specific global dynamics in the bulk. This could be seen in a second order formalism using Einstein's action. It could be seen equivalently also using what is called the Chern-Simons formulation of pure gravity. In three dimensions, pure gravity can be rewritten as a Chern-Simons theory. It was alluded to many times today by doing the following. You take the local frame, the dry bind in three dimensions. You subtract the spin connection, or you add the spin connection. You define two fields. These turn out to be fields of SL to R, of the so gauge fields of the gauge group SL to R, well, of the algebra of the gauge group SL to R, and the action, Einstein's action, can be rewritten as a difference of these two terms, of the Chern-Simons action for one of the SL2 minus the Chern-Simons action for the other. Okay. K, this parameter, is related to the anti-de Sitter radius, here unwittingly it became a lowercase L, same as before, and the Newton constant G. Why is this nice? Because then in canonical quantization, in canonical quantization, you, in Einstein's gravity, you can compute this action on complicated manifolds. In canonical quantization, the spaces that you can study are somewhat restricted, are a two-dimensional surface with one boundary, remember, ante desideras one boundary, which is a circle, times time. Right. On this space, actually, you can, again, define time and space, and if you look at the projection of the equations of motion that you obtain from this action on this surface sigma, you'll get that the equations are actually constraints. They say that the magnetic field on this two-dimensional space sigma vanishes, and that means that locally, but not globally, your gauge field is a pure gauge. It can be written as a pure gauge field, at least patch by patch. So locally you have no dynamics. It seems that you can remove your field with a gauge transformation. Again, I use Chern-Simons because the picture is clearer. I could have worked harder and said what I'm going to say also in the second order formulation. Now, in the particular case of 2+1 dimensions, the space of flat connections, so F equal to zero, modulo gauge transformations, actually has a description that is quite simple. It's actually a direct product of two spaces. So you have, how do you obtain this? Well, you obtain this, first of all, by taking your two-dimensional surface, which has one boundary, and taking out a collar. So imagine that you have this thing, and you take a disk, right? So you take out a collar that I represent in this way. On this collar, now you are free to choose at the. Now, you see, the idea is that here is the boundary, this piece will be glued to that. On this boundary, you can choose an arbitrary gauge transformation. The only thing is that you have to keep the holonomy, so the roughly the integral of the gauge field around this circle, constant. I mean, you cannot change that with a gauge transformation. So you take a gauge transformation that is a holonomy times an arbitrary periodic function with values in the gauge group, while here you take a gauge field which is only the holonomy, it's of a special form, and then you glue these two pieces. So in a sense, you have taken the boundary dynamics and just decoupled it from whatever happens in the interior. In the interior, you have extra degrees of freedom, but these extra degrees of freedom parameterize a finite dimensional space. So in other words, the classical phase space, not configuration space, the classical phase space that you obtain is actually made of two pieces, a piece that is infinite dimensional, but in a sense simple, it's a coset manifold, and a piece that's finite dimensional, but complicated. Now, Chern-Simons is too big. It describes not only gravity, it describes also a lot of nonsense that is not gravity. It becomes gravity when all the holonomies of this gauge field are what are called hyperbolic. And then in that case, there is a concrete description of the moduli space of this theory. It is a product of two spaces, a finite dimensional space called the Teichmuller space of the Riemann surface sigma, and the Katz-Moody, well, actually, what is called the loop group, so the group of all these gauge transformations that depend on the parameter, on the angle of the boundary, divided by a transformation that is just a rotation on the boundary. Now, the point is that, and this is almost the entire story, you still have to do one last thing. For arbitrary gauge transformations on the boundary, you do not get anti de Sitter. You need to restrict your gauge field at the boundary and have a special form, this one. And then the moduli space becomes a product of Teichmuller times the diffeomorphism of the circle, the diffeomorphism of the boundary, divided by S1. You have two gauge fields, A and A tilde, so you'll get two copies of this space. Now, the point is that this space is, at least we know how to quantize it. Not that it's particularly simple, but we know how to quantize this space because this space admits what is called a Keller structure. So you have a complex metric, but the metric is itself comes from a potential. It's the holomorphic derivative times the anti-holomorphic derivative of a function, of a Keller function. And it has a Keller form, what in mathematics is called a Keller form, which has a name, right? And that is what you need, the ingredients that you need to do a quantization using what is called holomorphic quantization. Holomorphic quantization is what you will do when you use coherent states for a harmonic oscillator. Now, The point is that that form, this Weyl-Peterson, has a Keller potential which allows to quantize the hard part, the Tikwiller space in holomorphic quantization. The quantization of the other piece of diff S1 over S1 is simple because the space that I wrote, diff S1 over S1, is actually a coset space. So we have a pretty complete theory on how to do geometric quantization on coset spaces. The upshot of all these stories is that the Hilbert space that you obtain in canonical quantization for a single gauge field is a sum of pieces. Each piece is the product of some whatever on holomorphic functions on Tikwiller space, and V is a representation of the Virasoro algebra with a certain lowest weight that's related to the holonomy by the equation that I gave here. Okay, so this, at least we get a space. The story is not finished because when we take a vector in this space, or the vector in the big, larger space, it may transform in a specific way under large diffeomorphism in the bulk, what are called modular transformations. This is because the norm in Keller quantization, the norm of a vector, is a holomorphic function, but I'm the exponential of the Keller potential. And under a global diffeomorphism, why the metric does not change, Keller can change. So since these transformations are also unitary transformations, if you want this norm to remain invariant, it means that the function psi, the holomorphic function on Tikwiller space, should also get some weight, right? Which is related to the way in which the scalar form transforms. Okay, so these are just rules of the game. Now, the point, the crux of the matter is that, of course, quantum gravity is not just one. And SL2, it's two. We have to combine them together, and then you can say, well, that's easy. Let's take the product of the wave functions for one and the other. Right. Well, that's not the complete story because this wave function this is a bit of an assumption, but it's reasonable to assume that in a theory of gravity, this wave function should also be invariant under large diffeomorphisms, at least large diffeomorphisms of the two-dimensional initial surface sigma. And if you do that, then under global diffeomorphisms, what happens is that the holonomies may in value remain the same, but actually the cycle on which you compute them changes. When you do a global diffeomorphism and you have two copies of Tikwiller space, so you can take your gauge field and compute it along one gauge field, take a loop around the handle of your space, compute the holonomy. The other gauge group, compute the holonomy around the same loop. Now, when you do a diffeomorphism, you are changing the two loops for both the gauge fields. Right? So you are taking, say, one loop, do a global diffeomorphism, and map the black loop into the red. But you do the same for the two holonomies, for the two SL2, which means that actually the space that you obtain is the product of two Tikwiller spaces divided by one copy of the modular group. Okay, so we have a better global description of this space, which tells us that the wave function that we get is a certain sum of products of wave functions that are holomorphic functions on the two copies of the Tikwiller space, and a vector that belongs to two representations of the Virasoro group. And that's invariant, actually scales as an appropriate form under global diffeomorphisms. Well, this space is nice, but it's still much larger than what we expect from ADS-CFT, and it's still to be properly understood. I mean, many of the things that I said here, except for the global diffeomorphisms, were understood in part in the 90s. I'm with a student where I'm still looking at this. The way to make sense, to see in which sense you have a duality in this enormous space is not clear to us yet, not completely clear. So, for various reasons. For instance, take a representation here for certain conformal weights. Here I actually have a modular invariant combination. This is a one-point function, so it's the expectation value of a vertex with dimensions h and h bar in conformal field theory. Well, if I have two conformal field theories, in principle, I have two different wave functions. But again, I have in two different conformal field theories that don't belong to the same space. I also have a different functions for each genus. So at each value of h and h bar, if I have even a single conformal field theory, I can compute the expectation value of a vertex, a genus 1, a genus 2, a genus 3, a genus 4, etc., and I still get wave functions that from the point of view of the boundary transform exactly in the same way under Virasoro. So it seems that the same primary appears an infinite number of times just because of the replica, the fact that you have infinite genera. So indeed, this thing is complicated, and again, due to the hour, let me pass to something else and ask if we can do something simpler than pure gravity and try to simplify life even more than we did before. In three dimensions, again, one of the nice things is that maybe there is something that in a sense is half gravity, at least classically. The action in this case is the standard Einstein-Hilbert action plus another Chern-Simons that is not the one that I wrote before, with this weight 1 over mu. So Einstein-Hilbert is this, okay, the radius of Antedesiter again became capital. And the Chern-Simons action is actually written in terms of the Christoffel connections like this. So this is what is called the gravitational Chern-Simons, which is not what I wrote before. But the sum of the two, in general, it's bad for generic mu in the sense that if you want black holes with positive mass, you also have ghosts in your theory. But at a specific value of this parameter mu, these ghosts disappear when you impose Brown-Hainaut boundary conditions, the ones that we gave at the beginning. But something else happens when you impose those boundary conditions, and that's the critical point. The two charges that I had before now change. You have one non-trivial charge which generates one copy of Virasoro, but the other vanishes for Brown-Hainaut. So in a sense, you have a square root or a half of pure gravity because you only have one Virasoro algebra. And on the boundary, you only have right-moving states. So, and conversely, if you take the other charge and you set it equal to zero, at least classically that defines a sector of this big theory that does not contain ghosts and, in a sense, is the best that you can call a half of pure gravity. When the charge is non-zero, the theory has ghosts. Whether this picture is true quantum mechanically is not clear. I mean, there are several hints that it's not. But at least classically, there is a nice story in which you can have less than pure gravity. But since the quantum story is unknown, let me come to the last two points that I wanted to mention. Another thing that you can do to your gravity is relax what we call Brown-Hainaut boundary conditions. In particular, you can make some of the components of the boundary metric, some of the order one components of the metric, dynamical. In particular, if you make this dynamical, you actually get an algebra that is not just Virasoro times Virasoro, it also contains some Kac-Moody factors. If you make this component dynamical, something even more interesting happens. You lose a Virasoro, but you gain an SL2, or a U1 if this mu is chiral. Now, in other words, you can, by relaxing these boundary conditions, which means by coupling your, if there is an ADS-CFT duality, by coupling a dual conformal field theory in the boundary to partially dynamical gravity, you can get these different algebras. And this is something that has been proposed recently, and with a student, we are looking at the implications, in particular, whether these algebras really help you for anything, or are algebras only realized in the gravity sector, which do not tell much about the CFT. Okay, final point. There are even higher spin fields propagate no dynamical degrees of freedom, and ADS-3 is unique because these high spin theories, though a little simpler in the bulk, actually are dual, if a duality exists, to interesting theories on the boundary. Unlike what happens in higher dimensions. In higher dimensions, well, first of all, the conformal group, as we just heard, is finite dimensional. This is the dimension of the bulk, for me, always. So, and it contains, can be decomposed in a maximal compact subgroup. SO2 gives us a conformal dimension that has to be larger than a certain value for unitarity, and S is the spin, and what you call massless in this case is when this delta saturates the unitarity limit. Remember, this is the dimension of the bulk, so it's one more than the boundary. Now, for this relation between the conformal weight, which is actually also the energy of my state, and spin, there exist interacting theory of massless high-spin particles. In ADS-3 and higher, actually. The most complicated cases are for higher antide-sitter, worked out by Vasiliev and many collaborators, and many in this room and at the Scuola Normale have done very important work for regarding these theories. Here I just want to notice that there is a proposed dual for these Vasiliev theories, and it involves mapping the massless high-spin fields, where the relation between conformal weight equal energy equal mass, morally speaking, equal spin, right, maps into a totally symmetric traceless current. Now, this current has to have the conformal weight that I gave here. And so, in order to compute, say, bulk dynamics, the idea is that you have to compute correlators, endpoint correlators of these currents at the boundary. Now, in dimension larger than 3, Maldacena and Zeboedov showed that the algebra made by these currents, when they are exactly massless and also when they are slightly broken, is the same as in a free theory, either made of free fermions or free bosons. But that's not true in 3 dimensions. So in a sense, the theories in higher dimensions are very complicated in the bulk, but they may have a dual description that is very simple. In particular, in the unbroken phase, where you have massless high spin fields in the bulk, the boundary description may be just a free theory, or at least a theory that has the same current correlators as a free theory. But in 3 dimensions, instead, the situation is more interesting. In 3 dimensions, there exist higher spin algebras, for instance, the WN algebras. I don't define for you what they are. I can only tell you that they are also asymptotic symmetry algebra for certain Chern-Simons theories that are the natural extension to the Chern-Simons theory of gravity, with SL2 replaced by SLN. Moreover, even Vasiliev's theories in 3 dimensions are, well, a few scalars, plus a Chern-Simons. So even these high-spin theories are actually very, well, simpler than in higher dimensions. There is a scalar sector and then a Chern-Simons, but based on a very strange group that is called high-spin mu times high-spin mu. Mu is a real number. In some sense, this is the analytic continuation of SLN for non-integer mu. And okay, here is the definition. It can be given an algebraic definition. So you have an algebraic definition for the high-spin algebras that reduces to SLN when mu is integer. Now, this Chern-Simons theory actually also has a Brown-Hainaut asymptotic algebra. You can compute the asymptotic algebra using an extension of the methods of Brown-Hainaut, and it can be understood as a particular limit of WN algebras. WN algebras also have certain central charges or levels called K, and this theory has as an asymptotic algebra a W infinity mu, where mu is a particular ratio of the n, which is also the maximum spin of the particles propagating in the bulk, and the level k of this algebra, which turns out to be the same as the level k of the SUN in the Chern-Simons description. And k, lo and behold, is exactly the same as in pure gravity, under the Sitter radius divided a Newton constant. Unlike for pure gravity, for these theories, you can take a semi-classical limit in which this k is large. Right? But mu can remain fixed because you can take a Toft limit, in which case large, and then it's large too, and they all go to infinity as the same power. Now, a very interesting observation is that this algebra also arises in concrete two-dimensional conformal field theories, what are called WN minimal models, that are certain coset models constructed in conformal field theories years ago, and given here for the experts. So it was, in a sense, natural but highly non-trivial to conjecture that the dual of these Vasiliev theories are an appropriate limit of these minimal models. So if you take these theories, you send n to infinity, k to infinity, you keep mu constant, you'll get an asymptotic algebra that is W, that is also the asymptotic algebra of the high-spin algebra of Vasiliev. So this was the conjecture of Gabardiel and Gopakumar, is that actually this conformal field theory is taught is non-trivial, interacting, right? But it's dual to Ante de Sitter 3 Vasiliev high spin theories. And this is a case that, unlike in higher dimensions, the bulk theory is non-trivial, but also the boundary theory is definitely interacting. And they performed many tests of light states, symmetries, deformations, etc. And for the time being, this conjecture has passed all these tests. So let me just conclude by my overview of ADS, my justification of ADS, by saying that even though gravitational waves do not propagate in Ante de Sitter, Antidesiter is nevertheless a very interesting and precious theoretical laboratory for quantum gravity and high-spin theories because it possesses some key features for d-gravity. I didn't stress that, but for instance, it has black holes. It also has a very large asymptotic algebra that reduces somewhat the dynamics to kinematics and allows to simplify our life when we try to understand it. So it is a nothing worth studying. Talking of a nothing worth studying, first of all, are there any Germans in this room? Well, yes, then I'll give an edited version of the story. So when I was a student in 83, and I asked various professors at the Scuola Normale for thesis projects, I went to Riccardo, and Riccardo said that his main interest was to predict what the next generation of machines will discover. He said every new machine, LEP will start very soon, any new machine has discovered something new except DESI. I won't tell the reason given in that occasion. But, the story has been more complicated in the sense that what we discovered was all a confirmation of the standard model. And we have not seen anything beyond the standard model, but that doesn't mean that we have seen nothing. I mean, there are things that were unknown until a couple of years ago that now we know. I mean, Technicolor, for instance, is for all purposes ruled out. We discovered the mass of the neutrinos, etc. So even that nothing was very worth studying. And I am saying that this more modest nothing is also worth thinking about. Anyway, thank you for your patience. And done.
Questions for Massimo?
Are there observable consequences of this?
Sorry? Guy, you always ask the same question. You should really try to change, right? I think that probably I'm not the only one in this room to think that in order to get the right answer, you also have to know how to ask the right questions. And I think that many believe that right now we do not really know how to ask the right questions for quantum gravity. So it's worth to study in some simple models. It's mathematical physics, but I mean, I think it's an interesting one.
Do you have time for a question, Augusto? Do you have time for an answer? There is this other kind of feeling that the dual theory to quantum gravity has to be a CFT with discrete spectrum and so on. Now you do everything according to your rules, but you get something which apparently does contradict to that feeling. So what's your take? Is there...
Well, my take is, first of all...
wrong?
Yeah, actually, my take is that... One could say, maybe we were misled. I think that, but I'm not going there. I'm trying to see if there is any reasonable way of reconciling what I see here with what we know from ADS-CFT. I mean, when you look at, say, the formulas for the entropy and subleading corrections to small black holes, extremal, etc., it works too well to be all an accident. One possibility, which, by the way, was hinted at by also by Maloney and Witten when they were also faced with their own set of problems, is that what we call pure gravity may need extra degrees of freedom, and in particular, long strings. If you have critical long strings in three dimensions, these objects can reach the boundary with giving them a finite amount of energy, and then the theory that you would get will have a finite gap and a continuous spectrum. In particular, one sort of, it's not even evidence, it's an anecdote, but if you just look at the dynamics of a critical string, so if you have a shell of matter, in a sense, with a given charge, it couples to the cosmological constant inside and outside the shell is different, and it has a certain tension. The two are matched so that the system is critical. Yeah. if you look at the dynamics of the subject and you take the shell, aka the string tension, to be very, very large, much larger than the Planck scale, then you discover that actually the gap that you get in the energy is finite, and in the limit that the tension goes to infinity, the tension of this string goes to infinity, the gap becomes exactly the minimum mass for a black hole. So so if you start, say, from an ADS with a very small curvature radius, a very highly curved antidesiter, and you shoot in a very heavy critical string, you get actually not an antidesiter space, but only configurations that have that belong to the black hole spectrum. So I don't know, maybe in some sense, if there was a sense in which I could believe this system with a very, very heavy string, right, then maybe I would say this is actually the right object. I mean, we get this discrete spectrum because we also have a very heavy string that does not seem to give anything for local dynamics, but it creates actually a finite gap. We know that in string theory, things never work that way. When one string becomes very heavy, other strings become light, right, by various dualities. So I don't know if what they got was just an accident or if it says something. But again, we are still trying to understand if we can understand something more. Otherwise, we'll leave it to others.